Stop it.
They help.
Wait, wait, wait. Okay. That's pretty good.
That's pretty good.
I'm making a mark.
Oh, that doesn't work. That's significant.
Yeah. The psalm for the year would be Psalm 143, verse 8. Let me hear in the morning of your steadfast love, for in you I trust. Make me know the way I should go, for to you I lift up my soul.
Hmm. That's a fairly good psalm for a year, for any year.
I know. I
mean, you know, awesome. I had Daryl Fish over last weekend and we did this.
Mm-hmm. Which I didn't watch.
And we talked about all, you know, music theory and stuff, whatever. Mm-hmm. and I turned the camera off, and he quoted Psalm 103, and then he talked about, like, he went into it, about how, like, the different aspects of...
Of course he did.
I was like, you couldn't have done that 3 minutes ago.
All the best moments really happen.
Thing is, sometimes
in real life. You can't capture it all.
Well, and like, he always wants to talk politics. And it drives me a little bit crazy.
He's never talked politics with me.
Well, it just must be my winning personality.
Yeah, it's a total lie.
Yeah, I know. And so I was trying to, like, I wasn't trying to avoid the subject during the podcast. We didn't really get into politics. But, like, I would have loved for that to have been on the podcast.
Yeah.
And it wasn't. By 3 minutes, it wasn't.
Those 3 minutes could change the world.
Well,
they could have.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the second Hijo. Whatever this is. I'm told it's not a podcast.
It's not. It's not a podcast.
I'm told I'm an ignoramus.
It's a video blog, which would make it a vlog.
Well, that's what I started calling it at first, but that sounded pretentious.
It also sounds...
like you're vomiting a little bit.
Well, yeah. Yes, it does.
Yeah.
sounds like a disease.
Are you going to read more? What are you doing? Oh, you're turning 103.
I went to 103.
Yeah. He separates our sins from us as far as the east is from the west.
Yeah. I was just, you know, referencing. So if you could pick, speaking of years, if you, one word for 2020, what would it be? One defining word for your 2020.
Wow, this is a terrible game. For my 2020.
Yeah, this is not, it's not a game. I'm genuinely curious about how you would define your year.
Work.
Alright. Change.
That's your word?
Mm-hmm.
Work and change.
Yeah.
I should have said hope.
But you didn't.
No, that would not define my year. Work. Yeah, work. I worked a lot. And I had a baby.
Hope is very biblical, David, but hope coming from you sounds like a joke.
But, yeah. Well, I hope in the Lord.
I know you do. That's why I am.
Good.
That's why I'm proud of you.
Proud of you. Ow, why'd you do that? This is why you want to sit next to me.
I told you that earlier.
You did
earlier.
Tell me this. I should have
I
been
told you that Lisa. I have spent my entire life physically assaulting you, so I don't know why on the podcast I wouldn't do that.
There's no reason not to.
This is real life. And this is not a podcast!
You see, you even call it a podcast. You dog bigot.
I am a dog bigot.
You're a dog bigot.
I'm a dog bigot. I really love that. I want you to make a shirt.
There's so many.
But I want you to make that shirt.
Dog bigot.
Yes. And I want to send it to some people.
What would be even funnier is if, well, I guess it wouldn't be that funny. I was going to say it'd be funnier if you said dog bigote, but it would only be funny if it was actually spelled with an E at the end, and so you could actually legitimately not understand it if you thought it was a Spanish thing.
Which I think would be funny, but you did make the point that no one would understand it.
Yeah, because it would be stupid.
But it would, but it's funny because I made the connection.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Don't patronize me.
Anytime.
I'm going to let you.
I'm not patronizing you. Your hat. Okay.
Aye.
So your hat has a rope on it.
Yeah, bro. It's hip.
I un. You uncoiffed
my hair. Do you know how to spell quaff?
With a quaffle.
You're stupid. Alright, sorry. You know what I mean? It's like when your hair is quaffed.
Yeah.
You know how to spell quaff?
Like David. Like, not David. Because you're David. What's his name?
I'm going to confess something to you. I have these two cigars left. I bought a variety pack of Olivas. The cigar is real dark. Mm-hmm. And I'm scared of it.
So let me ask you a question. Do you save some for later? Do you ever do that? Or do you have to go hard or go home?
I mean, it's not about going hard or going home. It's about the fact that when you relight an old cigar, it tastes like sawdust with poop in it.
Not necessarily. So I have actually smoked the lighter one, a smaller one.
Whatever, I'm going for it. We're here.
That looks beautiful.
I think it's going to be good, but it's so dark. Well, I talked to Franks about this concern. And he said, just pace yourself, man.
All right, well, I like Franks. It's good advice.
I like Franks, too.
I mean, I don't know him, but I mean, he gave you good advice is what I mean by that.
You met him.
Yeah, I did, but I don't know him.
This is Oliva Serie O.
Is it Serio?
I can't do this with you. The thing is that you think you're fun. You think you're laughing.
I am laughing. Because that was clever, David. And you know what? I don't need your affirmation.
I know that.
I felt pretty good about that all by myself.
You've proven that to me over and over again.
So yes, when I did smoke cigars, actually.
Back when I used to smoke cigars.
Yeah, I.
Oh man, it just smells so dark. Holy cow, I gotta take this slow. I bet it's gonna taste wonderful, but.
It smells wonderful. I can't remember what it was now because it was a decade ago. But I worked at the Chinese restaurant. Bottom line is we needed a beer for the afternoon break. So I went to Walmart, but I had smoked.
Did you get Walmart cigars? Oh.
No. I had time. It's Chinese restaurant, so you nap in the afternoon.
Yes.
You open for lunch, open for dinner, and nap. You worked there, you know.
I did work there, and so, I got my butt kicked in the Asian game at lunch breaks.
Well, Benny fried up whatever there was to fry, and then I was responsible for going and getting. We always drink Heineken. But I also had time to play chess with Don Mattis at the cigar lounge by Rockneys on Steel's Corner.
Oh, Smokers, etc.
Yes, thank you.
Which is a terrible name for a cigar lounge.
It is.
It was a nice cigar lounge.
It
too.
Was. Terrible. Well, we played a game of chess and I smoked real fast because I had to get to Walmart. Barely made it to the women's bathroom and vomited.
Oh, yeah.
All over the stall. I didn't make the toilet. I made the bathroom, but I did not make the toilet. It was awful.
Oh, that's rough.
Yeah.
You didn't respect the cigar.
I didn't, because I was trying to go fast, and I can't remember what brand it was now. It was light, though. It was very light. And it was just too much, and ever since then, I have an aversion to light cigars.
Well, you can't light them. Just, if you're going to smoke them, you have to light them. This is why I don't do puns. I'm just not good at them.
I'm not laughing at you, because that was stupid. That really smells robust.
It smells good. Yeah, it smells robust. That's what they say in Mexico.
Have you ever been there?
To Mexico?
Yeah.
I have.
Did you stay there or did you just walk over the line?
Yep.
So how do you know what they say? You just walked over the line, David. Well,
because they speak Spanish. What are you doing?
You have a hair in your...
I mean, it's like you just feel so...
Like I can get in your
at
personal
liberty
space?
To yeah, I do. Invade my bubble. Ouch. You pulled hair out of my head. Look, folks.
It's because I love you.
Oh, is that why?
Yeah. So I feel like you're not a very good authority in Mexico. Just because they speak Spanish, I think that makes you...
A dog bigot?
Yes.
Let's talk about dog bigotry for a second and Mexicans.
Okay. That's excellent. I would love to talk about dog bigotry.
Because you married a Mexican.
I did.
And listen to me. You've been concerned this whole weekend that my white granulated sugar in the cabinet and my Dr. Seuss books on the bookshelf.
They weren't on the bookshelf. They were on the floor. Oh. Which, according to you,
right,
is some type of redemption, but I don't know the jury's still out on it.
Well, they're on the floor because they don't belong in the shelf next to books that aren't.
They're in your home.
My point is... Anyway, hold on. No. You're turning around. I need to make a point.
Okay. I'm waiting.
You married a person of color. And had children with that person of color.
Yeah.
I didn't want to bring this up, but it makes you...
Well, you sound like you want to bring it up.
It makes you a colonizer.
It does not make me a colonizer. You know why?
You're going to justify it. And here's the thing about justifying
bigotry. Oh, David, okay, wait, hold on. You've been justifying...
It's just evidence of your racism.
Yeah, so no. Let's talk about evidence of racism, Mr. Granulated Sugar, all over the place in this home. You've been justifying...
But it's a real justification. I have white granulated sugar because I don't want to culturally appropriate someone else's colored sugar. Yeah, I know,
but there are too many instances in this home. That's the excuse that you have for every single thing that could be racially charged.
I had chocolate cake. You got on me for having chocolate cake. And my justification for that was not cultural appropriation. It was that I would never eat white cake. Because that is...
Okay, my point is that all of these justifications sound pretty self-righteous, and I would say that there's accumulation of instances in this home which would denote that things are not as they seem, or not as you say that they are.
Okay, well...
So you're a dog bigot.
Well, you're an unauthorized cat, so how about that? I wanted to play this song for you.
Okay.
I tried to play it for Daryl Fish... I've tried to play this for so many people, not this song. Sorry.
Did it not work? Cue me.
I've tried to play this for people, and they're like, yeah, it's cool. But they don't give me an actual opinion. Like, I played it for Franks and for Daryl Fish.
Did you play it for them on the cast? On the pod? No. On the vlog?
Yeah, stop calling
it a vlog. I'm going to call it a log.
The log.
This is a log.
Video log.
It's just a log. Remember that one time when we talked about logs when we went through? We had an entire conversation about bowel movements.
Did we really?
Yes! And it was hilarious.
That doesn't
and we
sound
kept
like
on
us.
Going and going and going, and it was. We came up with some pretty good ones. It was pretty punny.
Oh, puns.
Yeah.
Yeah, that does sound like us.
Well, there was a log.
Okay, this song is called By Fire, and it's by a group called Hiatus Coyote.
Okay, complicated name.
Yeah, it's a terrible name.
Wait on.
But the girl is she's such a weirdo.
Okay, that's a good thing.
Okay. It's got a super long intro. Okay. So, just hang on a few seconds.
All right.
Oopsies.
Is that the album cover?
They didn't appreciate it.
No, but I mean,
they didn't have an opinion one way or the other. Even if you didn't appreciate it, you'd have an opinion. They were
my opinion is that
sure.
I appreciate what she's doing vocally. Because even though it's not that complicated, still you have to.
You don't have to be able to hear.
The bass is what's holding it up.
Yeah, speaking of the bass holding it up. So I found it. Do you know the YouTube channel Julia Plays Groove?
No.
Okay, well.
Let me tell you how many YouTube channels I'm subscribed to.
How many? Tell me.
Probably fewer than 10. Tells you how much I spend time on. I mean, you, Alan, Steven Crowder.
Oh, great. I'm in such good company.
You know.
See, you are a dog bigot. You're subscribed to Crowder.
I'm casing the enemy, just like you said. Purveyor. I'm right. Purveyor.
I found the I found this song because of this chick. She does bass covers.
Oh wow.
And she
Well, isn't that a coincidence?
I mean her bass line on this song is so
Alright, I'm really excited to hear this.
I hate these stupid ads.
I know you can hear me. There it is. Lidl. Did you hear that? Did you hear that? Wait, did you hear what she said? Lidl.
Nuts eventually. I mean, not like super nuts.
Can you blow it up?
Sure. Oh, come on, music.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
She's awesome.
I know.
Look at the smile on her face.
I know, too. I love it. That's what I'm loving.
She's so amped. Like, oh,
she
it.
Should be. Wow.
Okay, well, that's a sign. You should watch it on your own time.
I will. That's amazing.
Yeah, she's great. She does, I mean, I found so many.
It's amazing that she is pulling from the, from.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I was looking at kind of the titles she was doing, so the different genres.
This is one of my favorites of hers, or it's probably my favorite of hers. But everyone should check out Julia Plays Groove. She's the man.
I love her. She's a woman.
Well, I'm a misogynist and a dog bigot.
I was
bigot.
Just going to claim misogynist. So, to the punch.
Yeah, she's really good. I find so many good music from her.
Yeah.
So many good music. So much good music from her.
There you went.
Yeah, this coffee's cold and gross. You know, are you familiar with Milwaukee Packout toolboxes?
No.
What do you want?
The Vienna place. I'm afraid when I go away, I won't find it.
Well, you should. We can send you home with one.
But, well, yeah. I'll get on the road.
That's part of that's like a toolbox system. Mm-hmm. And they all interlock together.
Oh, they do?
Yeah, well, I haven't seen. They snap, like, the there's a bottom unit that has wheels on it. And it's a big tub then. Yeah. And then they all have those things in the, on the lids. And so they all snap in place and you can, like, they're modular.
That's pretty great.
Yeah, so you wheel in your stack. I wheel in my stack. It's, like, this tall off the ground. Yeah, but it's got everything I need.
I should get that for my hut.
You should.
My husband, because I love him.
Wait till like Black Friday and go get it.
Yeah.
Dude, you'd love it. They're so
I know
good.
You would. Well, they go through so many sodas and waters anyway.
Yeah.
So this is, I'm drinking Vienna Lager, which is a product of the U.S. because I am a nationalist. Anyway.
How dare you? I wasn't even going to go that far.
Well, I said it.
I'm drinking Landshark. It's a product of whatever. Margaritaville. No, St. Louis, Missouri.
I don't really care because I'm adding some Himalayan pink rock salt and chili pepper.
She's putting salt in her.
Okay.
Here, people.
Have you tried it? Help. I don't need help. Look, I'm doing it by myself.
This is what happens when you marry Mexicans.
Yeah, you got the goods on the burr with the salt. There are so many different ways to drink beer. And
I'm sorry, did you say burr?
Yeah, I did. Burr with the salt. Okay. Whereas, what's his name today? Is we don't drink beer, we drink cervezas.
Yeah. Hey, man, go get cervezas. Not beer, man. Cervezas.
I love that so much. Yeah, it's like your chocolate with your whiskey that you were telling, or bourbon, I'm sorry, that you were telling me about.
Bourbon is a whiskey, is a type of whiskey.
It adds a new dimension to the flavors, and there's so many ways to accompany a beer.
Well, let's do this. If we weren't, as if we weren't pretentious enough already.
Like, are we going to get more pretentious? Because that'd be hard.
Comment on the video and let me know if you think salt in your beer is totally unreasonable.
Or, better yet, try it for yourself. Come up with your own evaluation. Be an individual.
Be true to yourself. Oh man, I had such a good ash. Did you see that?
I did. It was going strong. I saw it. I saw it. That was really sad.
It was sad. Can I get that brush?
Yeah, bro.
Man. My cigar ash brush.
Yeah, I like the cigar ash brush. I wouldn't put salt in every beer, but.
Oh, well, that's a relief.
David, shut up.
No.
It adds a different dimension. And this being caramel.
It is pretty caramel.
It is very caramely, and so
yeah, I guess when you put it like that.
Adds, it just pulls it up. Caramel is kind of, to me, and caramel is low and full and kind of round, and this salt adds like a little bit of a high note, just kind of pulls it up.
High note.
Adds a bit of yellow to the brown. That sounds like.
Oh. That sounds bad.
That's actually not gold.
It adds yellow to the brown.
A bit of
oh boy.
A bit of gold to the honey. That's better.
Let's not talk synesthesia because people will.
I was not talking synesthesia.
Close
I was saying
the book on this podcast.
I was not talking synesthesia. I was saying that.
You said the flavor of salt is yellow.
No. I didn't say the flavor of salt is yellow. I said because this is a caramely beer, the flavor is low and full, that the salt adds a higher note, which brings it from a honey-ish to a bit of gold into the honey. That's all I was saying.
That's not what you said. Do you know what you said? Should I remind you?
No. Okay. I have in my mind distinctly what I said. I don't want to repeat it.
Okay, good. Okay.
It was real bad.
It was bad.
It was real bad.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, okay, you go first.
Well, I feel like we both had something to say at the same time.
Yeah, well.
You go. You're the
Ron
guest.
Before Beauty.
I was going to say we should sing Tonada.
Oh, you going to do that now?
Well.
Have a drink real fast.
We don't have to. We can do whenever.
That's fine.
Unless you want to say that thing you were about to say first.
Yeah, I was going to ask you when we're going to get into patriarchy, but we can wait.
Into the patriarchy?
Into patriarchy.
Oh, let's do that.
I mean, we can wait.
I am the patriarchy.
I mean, I feel like
so
patriarchy is the draft in the room.
The draft in the room.
Right there.
That guy still doesn't have a name. He's my not my podcast icon. My
Your log.
What? That's right.
Your log con.
My log con.
So, how long have you had it?
I don't know. We were doing a...
Roughly?
Thank you for keeping me on track.
How long roughly have you had it?
Roughly a year.
Why does he not have a name?
No, his name. That's Spanish for, I don't know.
Thank you for clarifying that.
Also, this guy doesn't have a name. Oh, no, that's not true. His name is Gunther.
David, how, you can't have these things without...
His name is Gunther. I can find him. He's here somewhere.
Without some type of identifier, other than giraffe.
I don't know. He's here somewhere.
Well.
Joel Bear. Here he is.
Joel Bear. I really miss Joel Bear.
He went and...
I do.
He went and joined the army.
I know.
A long time ago. And now they sent him. This is Gunther.
Oh, nice. Oh, that's perfect.
Yeah. Joel made that.
He did.
He did. He whittled it.
He's so creative.
I know. He doesn't like to brag about it.
But he should.
No. I kind of like that he doesn't. Because that would be insufferable.
I would probably. There would be a time when I would have liked that he didn't brag about it. But now I feel like he should brag about it. I would be alright with that.
I don't want him to brag about it. I just want him to make more stuff.
I do too.
Yeah, I like these. He should make it out of real wood.
You know what this I love?
Pine 2x4. JGM.
There it is. I loved the model of Dad's desk that he made. Before he made the desk, he gave Dad the gift.
He didn't make a model of the desk. He made a model of the... Did he make a model of the desk
too? Yeah, he did.
He made a model of the before bench he had table made it. He made for Uncle Jerry.
Oh, really? No, he made a model of the desk, and I loved it. He's so creative. He's such an artist. Yeah, I... He came to visit me a couple of years ago because he was passing through for training, and he stayed for a couple nights, I think, and we went out, and it was just, we went to drink beer, and it was just such a, it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, well, he's a fun guy most of the time.
Yeah, most of the time.
Sometimes he's insufferable.
I think we're all that way.
Yep.
Except for me.
You should be ashamed of yourself.
I bet I'm not.
Yeah, he is a very creative person.
Yes.
But, Joel, I mean, how could you not be with
our
family lineage?
Mm-hmm, that's true.
Yeah, I know.
All right, we have to think of a name for this guy.
Okay, name him.
I'm thinking that.
Okay, you think on that for a little while.
Horatio, just kidding.
Oliva.
There you go.
No, that's a dumb name Ollie. For a giraffe.
Well, we'll think about it.
This is a really good cigar.
It smells amazing, let me just say. Especially, honestly, with this caramely beer.
It's the salt.
And the salt!
It does it. That's the thing that puts it over the...
The smell of the cigar with the salt in my beer. It makes it smell...
Have you been doing art at all? I guess you don't have time to do anything but take care of your chewing.
Alright, so I actually have been doing art. I express myself in writing bits and pieces. And also, I did a sketch of Santi, which I can show
you. Oh, I saw that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was very good.
I did a sketch of Santi, which wasn't complete, but I think I'm going to leave it as is. He was by the river picking up rocks.
Yeah, it's a great sketch.
Because that was his thing. And, you know, I don't know, we got out the watercolors the other day. But where I express my creativity most right now probably is in writing songs with him. Writing bits and...
With Santi?
Here and there. Mm-hmm.
Oh,
yeah.
Good.
Like our little life.
True.
You know? And he loves them. And
yeah,
so I am going to put him on a disc because Roy is there and he's got a portable studio. So.
You have them written down?
I record. No.
Oh,
I
just
record
on your
them.
Phone. Right, right, right.
Yeah,
right.
I just get the
audio. I forgot about phones.
Well, I just get the audio because I don't have time to write them down. Honestly. Then, and also in school, like Santi's preschool and in my home, that's where I kind of, you know, outlet my creativity. I outlet it. Yeah, so that's kind of where I'm expressing myself most, I would say.
That's a good expression.
Yeah, it is. And it involves my kids, so.
Right. I was just thinking, when Marie was deployed, I didn't like write full songs. I mean, I didn't write songs with Eva, but like I would be helping her get ready Yeah, getting her ready for daycare or whatever. And, yeah, I would be singing the things. I started singing the stuff that I was telling her to do. Yeah. Like, you know, get that shoe or whatever. You know, yeah. Put your shoe on. Yeah. Whatever, all the little things. Yeah. And, yeah, I should have, there were a couple memorable ones that were, you know, actually not bad melodically, and I think the lyrics were cute because they were just, you know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't know about Ava, but Santi, he is so musically inclined.
Although, it's not weird because you're his mom. If I didn't know you, I would think it's weird.
Yeah, but still, I'm his mom, and still, it's kind of astonishing how music and his understanding of it plays into his little life. But we do things like, in Spanish, like when it was time to take a bath, we would go, nos vamos a bañar, nos vamos a bañar, nos vamos a, nos vamos a, nos vamos a bañar. And then we could do that with anything, like, nos vamos a comer,
sure.
That kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And then also, he hated getting water in his eyes, or water in his face, so I wrote a little song about, you know, getting soap in his hair. Vamos a lavar el pelo, ya para quedar limpiecito. It was like a little, like, and then the other things, like, there's a show on Netflix that's actually pretty creative. The episodes are real redundant after time, but they're dinosaurs, but they're tools, and they eat rocks, and the characters are so creative. There's a little, he looks like a little lizard dinosaur, but his mouth is a tape measure, and they're always constructing things. It really is a brilliant
idea. The board meeting for that was like, okay, so let's take three things that we think young boys like.
Yeah.
Dinosaurs.
Really? Rocks, tools.
Rocks and building stuff.
And, well, it's called dino trucks, so you add trucks
dino
in there.
Truck.
Like the raptors are, I'm making a fool of myself, can't remember the name. But there's another dinosaur, and his tail is basically like a screwdriver. He can put any bit on it that he wants, or any size, any whatever. He's got the connection. And so I started a song, and he sings it all the time. I'm a dinosaur, and I eat rocks, 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 rocks. And it just goes on, and he loves it. And so those kinds of songs, you know, they mean something to him, but they also are melodically happy. And then we do songs to remember songs, and we put little emotions, and we talk about what it means. Like, he learned what storing things meant, because I have stored up your word in my heart. So nice. We went around, now we go around, and thy word is a lamp to my feet and light to my path. Now he identifies paths.
Very good. Thing.
Like, I have stored up your word in my heart. You know, those are the kinds of creative things that I get into.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
I like that.
It's also a way for me to share my creativity with him. And, mm-hmm. You know, he's my little duckling. He follows me around.
He is a little duckling.
And,
he's a cute duckling.
But he's so independent. But he, you know, he's got me pegged as like a mom, bing, 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 bing. So he goes and does his thing. Then he comes and gets recharged. And then he goes and does his thing.
Sure.
And,
that's an interesting way to think about it.
If I walk, you know, I know that if we're going somewhere, he might be over there. But he'll be, you know, he'll be following my little trail. So that's, you know, sometimes it's easy to feel like, or it has been, not so much now, but easy to feel like I don't have an outlet for myself, but my kids are my outlet. And
well, it also makes sense to pursue that as an outlet. Mm-hmm. I thought about a while ago, well, like years ago, the idea that, like, I was thinking about it in terms of fitness, because I didn't have a whole lot of time to work out, but I was working at Lowe's, and it's a big building with a big parking lot. And so on my lunch break, I just put on my running shoes and did laps around the property. I was thinking about the idea that, like, if you need to make something happen, you make it fit into what you've got.
Yes.
And so, like, it makes sense for you to pursue expressions of art with your kids, because right now that's what you have to do. Right. You have kids that demand, you know, all of your time. Mm-hmm. And so instead of, you know, neglecting artistic expression, you make it fit into the paradigm that you occupy.
Yeah, and, well, not only that, art is a language.
That's true, too.
So it's certainly a valid means of communication.
Can you, turn around and get that heart painting?
Yes.
Eva did the red.
Oh, she did?
Yeah, and I was like, that looks like a heart.
Oh, I think I remember. Was this on something else that you said or did?
Oh, maybe. I don't know. I might talk about it before. I meant to, I overshadowed what she did, because it actually did look like a heart.
Yeah.
I meant to do this a little bit more sparingly to make it less,
well,
whatever.
Not that sparing, David.
I know. I'm a terrible father.
Yeah, you are. But that's
but really, yeah, like that, I would like to do that more in the future with her, mm-hmm. like have, like, compilations of her stuff, yes, with my stuff on one.
Yeah.
On canvas.
That'd be great. Cause
yeah, it's so much fun.
It is so much fun. And, you know, I think so many people, or maybe we as adults, once we get to what we call the real world, we totally discount how important those things are in our lives, because they're so sensory. And so we're all about
business.
But our world is taste, touch, sight, and smell. So... and obviously, I mean, their brains are firing at an inconceivable rate, and they're making millions of connections all the time. And so, you know, the videos have really replaced tactile learning. But that's the video, even if it's educational, that's not what's going to make it. Will make a connection, but oh, David!
I'm an embarrassment.
We'll remain silent.
Thank you.
I wish. Oh,
keep
sure,
it
I
to yourself.
And I'm just like this.
Stop. You're so mean. Anyway, you want to talk about the patriarchy for real, or are you just throwing that out?
No, I do want to talk about the patriarchy.
Why, but
I
have to
talk
first.
About our kids. Oh, okay. I can drink some beer. Okay. I actually also have to pee.
We can edit this out.
We are not going to edit. Okay. Dead time for peeing. Should be edited.
Yeah.
No, I don't want a monologue. I mean, I could monologue. I could talk about children, and I could talk about how we are losing childhood in our culture. We're losing it because we as adults are erasing it. It's a double standard and quite ironic, because we believe that our children are ready for thematic things, and now that gets into their biology a bit, because there are physical stages and measurable stages of development for all human beings. Obviously we develop at different rates, but there are standard phases for biological females and standard phases for biological males. I'm monologuing.
I can tell. I heard you monologuing.
Yep. That's not even fair. Did you just go pee out there?
Of course.
I'm so jealous.
Speaking of different roles between men and women,
Ugh, man.
I can pee standing up without
making
a mess.
Well, I can too, but it's not the same.
No, it is not.
I'm talking about, did you hear me at all? Could you hear what I was talking about? I'm talking about the double standard for expectations in regards to childhood development. Mm. We as adults, or in this culture anyway, we expect kids to be perfectly ready to engage with, and what? Oh,
I had a smoke ring.
I thought you were pointing to the door. To engage with and accept very thematic elements as far as violence and sex and all kinds of things. But educationally, we dumb everything down. We take we take everything down to a level. We have to make sure that everybody feels like they're a winner. And we, even the way we talk to our kids, we don't expect them to be able to know or understand certain things. But we send them, you know, to the wolves thematically. And so it's a real double standard. That's kind of what I was saying.
That's fair. There is an aspect of, like, it's so easy to try and come to your kids' level in like, even just explaining new things to them, to try and come to get on their level, to tell them about new things, or like explain, answer questions for them, or even reading books to them.
Yeah.
And there's obviously that is valid to an extent, but I don't know who said, I mean, it's probably a fairly common idea, but like teaching your kids, talking to your kids, reading to your kids, with material and speech and whatever that is just a little bit out of there, just a little bit ahead of where they can grasp, because you're always pushing them to expand what they know, like expand their standards of knowledge and learning. Like if you stay a little bit ahead of them, you know, they have to work to figure things out still. And I, like, even with Eva, like, I won't let her read, I mean, on her own, like, on
Dr. Seuss.
Well, obviously, because Dr. Seuss is a racist.
He's a dog bigot.
No, but like, I don't let her read. Well, like, when I read books to her and she goes and picks out a book and whatever, she knows now that if she picks out a baby book, I won't read it to her. Mm-hmm. And so it has to be a book with like real words and stuff. Like, I don't even read Sea Spot Run to her anymore. Or like Spot and his mom. Whatever. We have one Spot book, I think, and it's like with his, he finds his mom or something like that. Or his mom's looking for him. Whatever. The point is,
His mom's looking for him. We have that one to lift a flap. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah. And that was great. It was a lot of fun. Yeah. When she was, you know, very young, when Marie was deployed, that was one of her favorites, and she learned how to make all the animal noises, because there's always a different animal underneath the flat.
Yes.
It was great. But like now, I won't read that one to her as like our nighttime book.
Right.
Because it's, you know, she's got that. She you know, mm-hmm. it's below her. I mean, obviously she can't read the words, but
yeah.
So like I'll read Madeline to her, and that's a fun one for her, because she's always asking, like, why are all the girls crying or whatever? You know, when they're all crying because they want their appendixes out too, because, you know, they're missing Madeline.
Yeah.
And so like there's so much, and on based on every page, there's something that she's wondering. She's like, why? She's trying to make the connections of why what's happening is happening. Or like when the man steals the purse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She's like, why is that bad man running from, running, you know? Mm-hmm. I don't know. So it just keeps her engaged, and she's able to.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, you know, we are, as parents, we are here to help our children make those connections. But it's like with the verses I was talking about earlier. A path and storing things, that kind of terminology is completely foreign,
right?
But not only does it give us context for what we're reading, but it also gives us context when we begin to explore those things, and when we begin to even some answer or define some of those things for our kids, we're not just, you know, keeping things just out of reach so they have to reach a little further. We do that in a sense, but also we help them make the connection and then think critically about things on their own.
Sure.
By identifying a foreign concept for them, and then they can go around and begin to identify it for themselves and make connections with other things in their lives that we haven't even talked about.
Right.
Like storage.
I mean,
right.
For example.
Yeah, exactly.
Just name one. You know, just a fairly typical. Oh boy, like storage.
I mean, you know, yeah, and it's so effective for them because they're investigators.
Right.
They are investigators, and boys and girls typically investigate a little bit differently, but they're still learning about the world, and you can't help. Those connections won't be made. That won't be established in the way that they need to be established unless you're protecting them from things that are, again, I'm going to use the word thematic because it's the best way to describe to all encompass, yeah, you know, it's all encompassing. Right. You're protecting them from that which is thematic, which they're biologically, physically not ready to
process,
right. But you're instead, you're opening up the world and leading them through expansion, through problem solving, mm-hmm. through a knowledge of relationships and even emotions. I mean, all of those things are what their brains should be doing, and that's what they are doing. And they're either going to do it poorly or they're going to do it well.
Yeah. I love taking Ava to work with me.
Oh, does she go to work with you?
Sometimes, yeah.
I love that. I didn't know.
Yeah, and it's just interesting how many questions she asks.
Yes.
Which you expect, like, you know, kids ask all the questions. They ask all the questions. But it's so funny, like, every single thing I do, in trying to accomplish one task, you don't even think about how many individual tasks there are within that task. Mm-hmm. But she asks every single thing, what are you doing now? And it's like, oh, I'm getting a screwdriver. Yeah. Well, why are you getting a screwdriver? Well, because, you know.
Yeah.
So you end up, walking this kid through.
Yeah.
Dude, I had to, I still didn't fix it because the drain snake broke. But I have to snake out my main drain still because there's something in it. I don't know. But anyway, she was underneath the house with me.
Oh, was she?
Yeah.
Damn,
she had her boots on, and I said she probably needs gloves and boots. She wanted to come underneath the house with me. I was about to go underneath. And I was like, man, I don't know if that's good. I was like, all right, fine. Well, you need gloves and boots and, long pants if you're going to come here. And so she was like, oh, and then she went inside. I was like, okay, I guess she's not coming. And then next thing I know, she comes out. She's got her boots on. She's got socks on her hands.
That's great.
And she was like, okay, daddy, I have gloves and boots. Anyway, so yeah, she was coming underneath. And she was holding, for this particular snake, you have to hold, one specific button while you also feed the thing. And it's real loud. Like, it's a loud thing, and it's clunking around every time. It's a spinning mechanism inside it. It rotates real rapidly, and so it's, gyrating and whatever. Yeah. And so she was pulling her ears. But then I was like, I really needed a third, I actually needed a third hand to be able to do one certain thing.
Yeah.
And I was like, honey, do you think you can hold this button down? She was like, okay.
So
she was
yes.
But it was I don't know, it was just so gratifying to be under there with my kid and she's getting dirt all over her face and stuff. And I don't know, just trying to fix the drain with my 3-year-old daughter.
Yes.
I don't know, it's a blast. It's a lot of fun.
It is a blast. And it's also so amazing. Those experiences are amazing in and of themselves, but then being able to take a step back and see what they've learned in a different context or what they're thinking about, because sometimes it's easy to take it for granted because we're with them all the time. Or I'm with my boys all the time. I'm with Santi all the time. So sometimes he doesn't even respond to me necessarily,
right.
He goes and does his own thing, but then when he's with someone like mom, she'll ask him things, or I'll give her kind of a prompting and she'll prompt him, and he's way out of her. He's got it all down. He already knows. And he, situations like that with you and Ava, sometimes he might be wanting to be very much a part of what's going on, and sometimes he might just want to be observing. And it might seem like he's not involved, but then he goes somewhere else, and he's picked it all up, and he's applying it to another situation. So
yeah, it's amazing.
It is. It's gratifying, and it's not just gratifying in the moment. It's just it's a gift that keeps on giving.
True that.
Yeah.
Like the patriarchy.
Yes. So speaking of patriarchy, for the love of patriarchy. Yes.
You brought it up. I was just bringing it around.
Yeah, I'm glad you did, because I think it's something that we should talk about while we're on this cast.
Me too.
By that, I mean log.
Yeah, it's not a podcast. Stop calling it that.
Log.
I'm ashamed of you. I'm ashamed to know you.
You're not ashamed to know me. You love me.
I do love you.
So patriarchy is, we can get canceled on YouTube for saying satanic things like this. But I saw a diagram of a man.
I don't know if this is going anywhere good. Should we stop this?
No, it's actually good, but things? That... No.
Can you give me a water?
Yeah.
Here's what I'm going to do. Sorry. I know I'm interrupting you. I have a little bit of coffee left in this mug.
Yeah, you're going to give it to me?
No. I'm going to put my lager in the coffee.
Oh, will you tell me how it is?
I'll do you one better.
Let me taste it.
If you want.
Okay, well.
You saw a diagram of a man.
Yes. A computer generated image.
Oh, no.
Uh-oh. CGI.
Okay.
And it was, I'm going to pull it up because it was actually really great. I loved. Oh, there's my pastor. He's had us on his mind and he wanted to check on us and ask how we're doing. He does that periodically.
Well, I'm offended that you're reading your text messages on my log.
Listen, it just popped up. It's from my pastor. So I really feel like you shouldn't be casting any stones over there.
I'm not casting stones. I'm casting aspersions.
Yeah, well, to me it feels like the same thing. I'm fairly sensitive.
You should taste this. I don't know what to compare it to because...
You don't have any context for comparison?
That's correct. Tastes good, though.
Good. Look at the title of this.
I don't have any glasses.
Well, put your glasses on, son!
How God made man superior to woman. Oh, no! You misogynist!
I am.
Patriarchal.
And this came from an article... That was written by a man.
Well, no wonder.
Okay, so give me this.
Okay.
Because I want to talk to you about it.
What did you think of this? Can you taste the coffee?
Yes, I can, and I actually really like it.
No, stop it. Stop it.
David, have you tried beer with salt? David, you're saying stop it.
Okay.
I...
Dámelo el sal.
Stop being a little girl.
See, now who's being patriarchal?
I'm just being condescending.
No, you're being misogynist. Well, calling me a little girl as...
I'm a female, which automatically puts me
in
a higher class of victimhood than you. So whatever you say is really actually moot.
Moot.
You're a moot. Yes. Uncle Max... I want to send this to Uncle Max because it's part of a conversation that we had. I guess we didn't really have a conversation about it, but... There was just a commentary about men being physically stronger.
That's weird.
But it's good.
I don't know
about it with coffee. Let me try it.
It's also sitting on top of the head of the beer, which is just... No, no.
Just kidding. I'm not going to do it. I promise.
Anyway.
Yeah, so things like vision. Men have superior tracking ability and night vision. They have superior sensory motor skills because there are more connections from the brainstem to the spinal cord. Oh. They're taller than average. They have 50% nerve receptors, which makes them feel less pain.
Oh,
they have 40% more upper body mass, 25% thicker skin, better clotting, which makes him heal faster, a larger heart with more red blood cells, which gives him better endurance, denser bones, and stronger ligaments and tendons. 33% more lower body muscle mass, and taller on average by 6 inches. And so the guy, he titled his article "How God Made Men Superior to Women" so that it would catch the eye. But with that, I love that diagram. I wish that you could see. There it is. Okay.
Wow, that was effective.
I know. So I did it. I loved it because. If you think about the role of a man and the role of a woman, and I know people hate the word role, but everybody's role-playing, so it's a bunch of bullshit. Am I allowed to say?
No, you are not.
Okay. It's a bunch of...
Actually...
Bullcrap.
You can say whatever you want.
Well, I will be...
My pastor's kids are watching this.
Okay, so it's very, 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 very hypocritical. And...
Well said. It was very articulate.
Well, I was just... I'm making the point.
Oh, I don't like it. I don't like it.
You can give it to me. It's fine. Wah. My point is that men and women biologically are different, and it doesn't matter what side of the belief spectrum you lie on. And I know that, you know, in the age of cognitive dissonance, reason means nothing. But, you know, people who believe with their emotions and will not subscribe to reason, I'm just going to tell you, if you're engaged in cognitive dissonance in and of yourself, you're never going to fit the pieces together, okay? So you're going to just be suffering your entire life, so get it together.
To the camera, folks. It's real.
It's real.
Aside from that,
men and women biologically are different, and it serves a purpose.
Yeah.
And it serves the purpose of an established hierarchy or patriarchy, which is not a bad thing. There is an established order because, imagine, men, I know, we'll just be very general, the hunters, the gatherers, women, the nurturers, that's anathema to our society, but men are amazingly programmed to be the hunters and gatherers. Imagine if a woman, an emotional woman, tried to go out and like hunt things all the time and kill or go to war. She's not responsible for the protection for a reason, and her biology falls right in line with that. That reason is to rear her children, to provide for her husband, which actually is exactly what he needs. He's not stronger without her. He needs her. So women are not inferior to men in that respect. Men have superior biology, like better tracking and thicker skin, more blood, because they are the providers. If I'm going to have somebody providing for me, if I'm going to hire a bodyguard, I'm not going to hire, you know, Steven Sissy over there on the corner.
I'm going to hire Marie.
No, but I, as a woman, even if I'm not a woman, if I need protection or if my children need protection,
yeah, it makes perfect sense. Men are bigger and stronger.
Well, yeah, and better.
Can I have a beer? Can I have a regular one?
Oh, David.
An unsalted beer.
Yeah, you can.
I
You got one chance. I almost dropped this whole thing.
Thank you.
Not just protectors, but providers. And so your biology as a man is set up to protect and provide.
Yep.
Physically. It's not just your role. It's scientifically how you're composed and made up. And as a woman, an emotional wreck.
Emotional wreck.
No, but as a nurturer, I don't have thicker skin because I don't need thicker skin. I'm not going out there. I'm not going to war. I don't need to be... There are women who go to war. But I'm just saying, I am a wife and a mother, so my husband is the head of my home, and I am his companion, and I'm also his helper, and I wouldn't do a great job of that if I were, you know, involved in things outside of the home, or if I tried to be the protector and the nurturer. That just would not work. And I have an amazing home, and you have a wonderful home as well. And we are mutually satisfied with our lives.
Yeah.
With our life.
I think it's important to point out that that's one step down the road, too. Like, the pointing out the biological differences and the scientific evidences of how men differ in their strength, you know, differ in that they are stronger and more equipped for providing and protecting is one step down the line of the conclusions that we need to draw in that men are built that way because the Creator established that they would be the head of home.
Yes.
And the provider and the protector, mm-hmm. and that women, the wife, the woman, would be subservient to the man in the home model. Obviously, that's a pretty controversial thing today, but like, it's important. I think it's important to start everything you said is true. It's important, though, to start from a presuppositional point of view that says we're going to presuppose what the Word of God says about men and women is true, and the biological and scientific evidences of the differences between men and women are facts which support that presupposition. Mm-hmm. But we start with Scripture. And obviously when I say women are subservient to men in the home, that's the thing that gets so much hatred from the opposition. And I understand why. Because oftentimes that position of headship and strength is abused to the detriment of women. But it's important to point out that God made man to be the strong and the protection, and made women to be the nurturer and the helper.
Yes, and what I'm saying, and what this article was highlighting very appropriately, was that our...
Can I see your Bible?
You can see? Our... I'm a music, what do you expect?
More. I expect more from you.
You're not going to get more. Our biology is... just, it makes it that much more incredible. Biology is already incredible, but it makes it that much more significant, especially now when we're trying to equalize everything. We're trying to find a great equalizer for all things, which is ridiculous and has never worked and never will work. It's literally the perfect marriage, and I don't say that as a pun. I mean, it's the perfect. The pieces fit together so perfectly in every way, and that's one reason that patriarchy is so important. I mean, it's important because it's God's established order.
Right. Yeah.
Patriarchy literally means father rule, and in some societies, that turns out to be quite oppressive. But that just goes to show what happens when there's a divergence from following the Lord. And it's like with anything else, there are so many things that are supposed to be and were created to be wonderful and complete and fulfilling. But when they're used wrongly, the result of what that wonderful thing is supposed to be is destruction. It's either life or it's destruction. It can't be anything else. So if it's not used as it was intended, then it does cause, whether immediately or down the line, much damage and destruction.
Well, yeah, and that's, I mean, not to be too on the nose with it, but I sort of hesitate because it sounds pretentious, but it does go back to the God. It is a gospel picture, like what you're saying in terms of when a model diverges from what
God's ordinance.
Yeah. That's what the fall of man was about.
Yes.
Because Eve sinned first. She was the one who partook of the forbidden fruit first. But the Bible doesn't say, "For as in Eve all die, but in Christ shall all be made alive." It says, "For as in Adam all die." So, like, as a man set as overseer and as head of my home, mm-hmm. I'm also held responsible for that role.
Right.
Hi.
Oh, I'm sorry.
See? You see?
Yes, let me just shake it.
Oh my goodness.
I'm sorry. I was like, well, it's probably out here.
It is. I'm sorry, Marty.
It's an unreasonable.
You know, I esteem you and I feel like I've let you down many times over.
Anyway, so Adam was held responsible for Eve's sin. Obviously, Adam sinned also, yes, subsequent to Eve's sin, but Eve sinned first. Mm-hmm. But the curse is found in Adam.
Yes,
and obviously, Genesis 3:15 is the whole deal. I will put enmity, this is talking to the serpent, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. So obviously, mm-hmm, we're talking about Jesus there,
yes,
who crushes the head of Satan, though he bruises his heel. So like, that's the curse, but that's also the promise of redemption through Christ. And so, like, Adam is held responsible for Eve's sin, ultimately, and we all suffer for that. And because of Eve's sin, she's not acquitted of her sin by any means. That's why there's pain in childbearing. That was the promise because of Eve's sin, there would be pain in childbearing. But there's also the promise in, I think it's 1 Timothy, women shall be saved through childbearing. What does that mean? Jesus was born of a woman who was undefiled by man. She was a virgin. She gave birth to the Savior. So man is the head of his home and is responsible for the sin and righteousness of his home. And women, women are not free of that curse. But in both instances, there is redemption, but through Christ. So the biology and the science and stuff is an incredible,
yes,
just picture of
it is
how intentionally men and women were designed.
Right, and the reason I come at it from the biological angle is because of how far led astray we are culturally now.
Yeah.
How embroiled society is in nothingness. In the chaff that's going to be blown away with the wind, because everything in creation has a reasonable and scientific correlation with God's ordination of natural law.
Yeah.
And natural order, as we understand it humanly. And it plays, you know, the roles that we occupy as men and women, they are very satisfying. I know that any feminist can get in my face or scream and shout and get angry, because that's what they do, but I'm
careful.
Okay, that was a
honest. You're painting with a broad brush.
Honest.
Honey.
That was not broad. It was actually quite literal.
Quite pointed.
I have lots of examples. But I am satisfied. I am fulfilled. I'm living as I was intended to live. I'm living using my creativity. I am living with much freedom, because there's a direct correlation with my subscription to this patriarchy, to this order, the fact that my husband is the head of my home. Mm-hmm. And you know, my husband is not really a believer, and I still subscribe to his authority, and we enjoy a peaceful home and a wonderful marriage, and you know, that's also the Lord's providence.
Sure.
But it would not be so fulfilling if we were striving to arrive at some bogus equity.
It should also be, like, I think it's important to say, too, that there are certainly, like, fulfilling marriages that don't necessarily
subscribe to this model.
Right.
It's true.
And but the point is that there is meaning in the world. There is truth in the world. So yeah. Even if you have two marriages, one is striving and struggling to follow this model, and the other is being pragmatic and doing whatever they feel is best for them, and it doesn't look like this model, and they are experiencing joy and happiness, and the couple who's trying to make this model work, even though they struggle and are in pain and, like, you know, at loggerheads, because this will cause strife at times, option A is still objectively, by the biblical standard, a better option than option B, because ultimately it's an obedient option. It's the obedient model. So even if temporally it's harder and there's more struggle and more difficulty and it's baffling in its pain, it's still good. It's good because it was given to us by the one who is good.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's good. And actually that brings up a very good point. That is true. And the point is, the unstated point is that this world is not our home.
No, yeah, there it is.
And so, it's very difficult to be kingdom focused when you have your here and now.
Yeah.
And so I will say that sometimes that's a struggle of mine, or it's something that, oh, my baby's needing a milking.
Oh, well, you can pause this if you need to.
Well, let me just say this. Okay. It is... Now I left my train of thought because I was thinking about milking.
I hate when that happens. I think about milking all the time. You know what I'm saying.
You don't even know, bro. Okay, so... you know, it's easy for me to lose the kingdom perspective because... And this is... The Lord appointed... I know the Lord appointed me in this place and time... as the wife of Gonzalo and as the mother of my children would not exist without my union. And so the peace that I enjoy in my home, that is given by the Holy Spirit, and it's his protection for his means. He knows what those means are. And sometimes, you know, we get clued in, sometimes not, but it's much harder to have a kingdom perspective because mm-hmm. I have joy and peace and fulfillment in my home. And so that's actually another thing that's categorized, not all of 2020, but especially after Christian was born. He was born at the end of August 2020. For those inquiring minds, know all of you wanted to know.
They were curious.
Yeah. That's been one of my main focuses is... Especially in reading the words of Jesus, thinking of what is to come, because mm-hmm. that's reality. This is what we know of reality now, but it's temporal, and it's certainly not the everlasting. It's not the everlasting life that we will have, and so being obedient to that model. Being obedient to the king and being ready and prepared for his coming and preparing my home and, you know, working in the field, you know, so to speak. Yes, my children, that's my children and my husband are my primary ministry, and that's a joy. But it is true that there are others who can grasp more fully or have a better picture sometimes of what it means to wait for the kingdom and to be ready to not be the virgin without the oil.
Okay.
You know? All right,
I gotta
take care of my baby.
Do you want to call it or do you want to come back and sing?
I kind of want to, yeah, let's sing.
Okay. nothing like crying babies.
Can I keep my hood up, actually?
It's chillier than it was before.
It is. That's the entropy, bro.
Can we talk about this being loose?
Mm-hmm. I think we should.
This is loose.
What were the name options?
Horatio. Homer.
Homer.
And Luis.
And Luis. And Luis.
It's Luis.
Is the winner.
Yeah, it was like hands down. So now he's got a name.
And I have a brother named Luis. Not a blood brother, but a church brother.
And you could that's make the case that it's a that's a blood brother.
Oh, snap.
I'm just saying.
Yeah, and I think we should make that case. Yeah, thank you for doing so.
You're welcome. Welcome!
So, we're back for real now.
Yeah, that was a...
We tried to finish, and it was a what you call a goat rodeo.
It was pandemonious.
It was rough.
Many small children.
Cue the montage of the chaos. That was a song called Eggs Benedict by yours truly. This is a song called Mexico by The Staves. F sharp. F. Okay.
I heard it's the place to go. I want to.
Chili. So, David.
Yes.
I've had two synthesizations. Okay.
Wow.
So, the first.
Synthesizations.
Oh, hello, so, sir. I generally don't put my babies on the internet, and I'm settling on Luis.
Paradis, paradis.
Ah! We have to get this. We have to sing a song. Rocks, rocks, rock.
Oh, look at this guy. He's
I
very
know.
Happy.
He loves music.
Así es como se enamora. Así es como se enamora tu corazón con el mío. Chulo. Tu corazón
okay.
con el mío. Tu corazón con el mío.
She's fine.
I think we should call it
many small
cue the montage of the chaos.
We could insert. You can even
I'm gonna
insert
put that
it.
In there. Yeah, for sure.
Good. There was something I really was trying to say for this wrap up, and I do not remember. And I've been trying to ask you all night since we went back inside. And I keep stopping myself, and now that we're in the moment, I have no idea what it was.
It was not that important.
No, it was important. Dang it.
Oh, well.
Oh, well. It is what it is.
That's true. I mean, having kids...
changes things.
It changes everything.
It does change everything.
Yeah. I don't know why you're smiling right now. You look
happy.
Because
I love my babies.
Yeah.
I'm smiling because having kids changes everything. That's pretty
true.
Great. Yeah.
It is pretty great.
Yeah.
They're pretty great.
They are great.
Yeah. So when you leaving tomorrow?
We're leaving tomorrow. Yeah, we're going back to... we're going to North Carolina.
First.
Tomorrow.
Yeah.
We'll probably stay... Oh, David! Is that in the screen? Can that be seen?
Oh,
I hope
sure.
so. Give me this. This is the... ash of shame.
Oh, that's so bad. Why did you do that?
It's the ash of shame. I told you why I did it.
Oh, man.
You deserved it.
This cigar?
That was a faux pas.
Fox pats?
Fox pats.
We talked about relighting cigars and how bad it is.
Is it bad?
No, well, the relight wasn't too bad. But this wrapper is so dark.
Is it?
It's like, I don't think I like it.
Aw, you sounded like a little kid. I don't think I like it.
I liked the cigar. The first two thirds were good.
Yeah.
This last third is
rough.
What you call Robusto.
Rough and tough for Robusto. Yeah, Robusto. That's how they say it in Mexico.
Yeah. Let's not do that again.
We'll be doing it for the rest of our
Are
lives.
Are you still singing? Well, I guess obviously you're not still singing. Whatever happened to the 1969 band?
They retired.
Wow.
So, the next youngest person in the band.
After you.
Was turning 60 or 50 something. And then the oldest person in the band was in his 70s. And he's, I'm going to do a racial profile here. He's a really skinny white dude. And he could throw down some Al Green. And he's country. This dude is country. Mm,
dude, I love
he
Al Green.
He throw down some Al Green like you would not believe.
Well, you guys played sick Motown.
You know, well, that's what they did. And I had a blast. You know, they were a bunch of old crotchety men. So it was a perfect fit for me. Because somehow that just works. I just get along with them. And they were, between them, and the musical knowledge that they had combined. And not to mention the years of experience. It's just... It was an amazing opportunity.
I gotta be honest with you though, I tapped out on that. That show we went to see,
mm-hmm.
It was like a 3.5 hour show you guys did.
I know. Really long.
I couldn't handle it.
I was excited, but it was tiring.
And don't say.
The thing is, we had two full sets, and each set was an hour. And then the break in between was, it was really long.
It was a long show. Yeah.
And then, really, the breakdown really happened over a period of time, I think. They had been together for a long time, so... most of them, so maybe it was like a... You know, it was like they were an old group of married couple, but...
An old group of married couple.
That's really...
You
know,
if you take my meaning.
That was a very apt description. I mean, it really fit it. The keyboardist had been there for 8 years, and... something the bassist who started the band said was offensive, because I think it was a joke that had racial something undertones or overtones or intertones, I don't even know. And so he wrote emails, and then there was misunderstanding, and it was
a mess.
Socially, I don't know, problems. And then one retired to Alabama, one went to Florida with his kid. The 70-year-old has a 14-year-old daughter, actually.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
That's quality.
With his wife, but they're divorced. Anyway, the point is, it doesn't matter. That's all the soap opera stuff. They were older than I and have been doing it for a long time. So they disbanded for that and political and social discord. So, and then I got married and became a mom. So I did start... I have recorded with them since.
Oh, cool.
But I've not been invited back because I was told by one of them on Facebook that...
You're not welcome anymore.
Well, he said that if I was going to vote a certain way, that I could unfriend him, full stop. This guy is a mathematical and musical genius. Literally, he's working on a brand new mathematical theorem, and I've seen his papers, and that's... socially and emotionally, that's where he is. So,
wow.
Yes.
I'm guessing if you were going to vote for Biden, he didn't want anything to do with you. That's what he was saying.
I was going to vote for Biden, and I was a disappointment. Yeah. So, it's a good thing you haven't seen my keychain. It's got his bust on there.
I have seen your keychain.
A Biden bust.
It's wicked sweet. It's not a Biden bust, ladies and gentlemen. It is a beer opener. A bottle opener with the regal profile bust of Donald J. Trump.
And on the other side is a signature. And the reason that I'm laughing is not because you're
it's
describing
because
you're my
a
keychain.
Dog bigot.
Well, but no, the reason I'm laughing is because I wish I had a picture of this. When I ordered it for myself as my stocking stuffer, because I knew that I was going to get it.
Wait, before you proceed. I just want to clear something up. So, did you vote for Trump?
David, are you going to make me say this in public? Because I don't want to cause any controversy.
Well, I'm not sure.
I voted for Trump twice.
Oh, man.
One's from a parking lot, and the other one from a nursing home.
I'm proud of you for that. Anyway, thank you. Continue.
Both under my non-assumed identity.
Non-de-plume.
Non-de-plume, yes. Okay, the reason I'm laughing is because I'm remembering how it came packaged. It came in this velvet bag, like about this size, that said, it said star on it. And when I opened it up, it was in this little plastic bag, and it had a huge sticker on it that said, made in China. It was hilarious, and I took a picture, and I didn't save it.
That's excellent.
Yeah, I wish I had brought it to show, but, you know, I stuck it
shut. Oh, speaking of presidents, I showed this to Daryl Fish. Look at this. I found that.
You did?
Yeah.
Where did you find this? Is that your part one?
Look on, yeah. Look on the aboard the presidential aircraft.
Where did this come from?
I found it on top of a book in my church.
You did?
Don't tell anyone.
I'm telling everybody.
Yeah. I told Daryl Fish that it's ironic because the matches amazing. Don't light.
Stop it.
They don't.
Wait. Okay. That's pretty good.
It's pretty good. What
a dud.
Oh no! That's even more ironic.
I know.
Okay, let's. We're,
oh.
I don't want to make people mad.
I want to keep trying. Oh, there's beer in there. Ah. I'm
joking. Why would you do that?
It's just a piece of wood. It's just a stick. The head didn't even make it.
I guess that's true.
I don't know where it went, but it didn't make it in.
Well.
And please, I know I probably look like a raging alcoholic. I actually don't drink alcohol very often at all because I don't
have
interest. Yeah, I mean, I don't have interest. It's not my social life. But also, I have kids and I breastfeed. But this is a very good beer.
Devil's Backbone, Vienna Lager. For those in the area.
It goes well with salt.
Doesn't. Everyone in the Hampton Roads area knows this beer. But okay. If you're not from the Hampton Roads area, if you can find Devil's Backbone somewhere, it's super yummy.
It really is delicious.
Yeah. It's good.
Oh, that's my baby.
I think that's my baby.
No, it's definitely mine. Oh, Lexington, VA. There it is.
Lexington, Virginia.
Yeah.
It's the spot. Well, we can wrap this up. Do you want to try it? We tried already to sing Tonada. Do you want to try to sing it or not? Do you want to review the lyrics?
What
first?
If we just do Give Him Mucho, like, in unison? Or is that not...
No, that's fine. I need the words. I'll go get the words real quick.
You can pull it up. Do you need the lines?
Yeah, I do. Okay. I sure do.
Okay. So I'll just talk to Luis and Gunther.
Yeah.
Or I'll just pretend. I'll just look at them. Joel, if you're watching this, I don't know if you are or not, but I just want you to know, and I want everyone else to know, that I love your woodworking. I've seen some of your whittlings and some of your little bird box you made for Mom, and I just really like your style. So, from a sister to a brother, from one state to another.
That rhymes.
Well, we're actually coast to coast.
Coast to coast, LA to Chicago.
Letting you know that I think you're an artist.
Oh, were you talking to?
I was talking to
Brother
Joel.
Bear.
Yeah.
Joel Bear.
And also I hope that we can. There's a seat for you here.
Dude. Joel.
If the three of us were together, I think
that would be
wonderful.
That would be outrageous fun.
And Joel and Gonzalo, I just want you to know that we poured one out for the homies, not on purpose. For David's birthday, he got a box of beer, and he opened my trunk, and the box of beer fell to the ground. Two beers were broken, so
two for the fallen homies.
Yeah.
The
absent homies, not fallen. Hope not fallen.
Yeah, well, they could be. We won't know.
We won't know until after this is over. But two for the absent homeboys, home slices that you got.
We so.
Dumped it on a truck for you.
Speaking of having Joel and you together on this podcast as a concept.
Yeah.
It's probably never going to happen because logistically it'd be tough and we would all have to commit to it.
Right, and morally it would be
No.
Taxing.
Let me finish. Man, this is rough. I had an idea for a podcast for the three of us to do. And it's called, we would call it Sibling Rivalry. Did I tell you about this? Oh, yeah.
I love this idea.
It would just be the three of us on a Skype call or whatever.
Yes.
Playing trivia games.
I think that would be amazing.
It would be amazing. It would be so much fun. But we would have to, like, logistically be really hard to do.
But I don't think it would be that logistically difficult.
Well, maybe we'll talk. Why. Okay, tell me why.
I listened to a podcast called, I can't tell you what it's called because I don't recommend it. Anyway, these three young ladies call each other every week from different areas.
Right, but look, you and I,
they don't have kids though.
Right, we have kids. I work all the time. You are always, Joel works. I mean, it'd be so hard.
All right, well, we'll talk about it. I think we can make it happen. My heart is in it.
Okay. My heart is pining.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Esa canción se llama Quiereme Mucho. That means love me a lot.
Yeah.
All right. Well, give me a starting note.
Like, I suppose.
Oh no! Sorry, I'm singing bass on my mucho. I do that every time.
I do too. I keep doing it to you, and you keep yelling at me.
That's probably fun.
All right.
Quiereme mucho, dulce amor mío. Amante siempre, te adoraré, yo con tus besos y tus caricias, mis sufrimientos acallaré. Quiéreme mucho, dulce amor mío, que amante siempre te adoraré, yo con tus besos y tus caricias, mis sufrimientos acallaré. Cuando se quiere de veras, como te quiero yo a ti, es imposible mi cielo, tan separados vivir. Cuando se quiere de veras, como te quiero yo a ti, es imposible, mi cielo, tan separados vivir. Tan separados, sí, es imposible, mi cielo, tan separados, vivir tan separados, vivir.
I think that was great.
Yeah, it was.
It was a lot of fun. It was too low. Well, no, it's good.
Actually, it was too low.
I wanted to, well, part of me wanted to be able to sing the octave above what I was singing. That's... But I also really, I think it adds a lot to have the low.
Was thinking that it was too low because I like it when we're on the same octave. But, you know, it still sounded good. It was pretty solid.
Yeah. It was fun. Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's a good place to call it.
Yeah.
I went in there to get this music and your poor son was cuddled up with Nana saying,
was he?
I want my mama.
Oh, poor baby. Oh, yeah. He's so tired.
He's very tired.
And you know, these kids, they've been stretched and they've done a great job.
These kids.
My final word is...
What's your final word?
Don't go sleeping because a little bad things can happen.
Don't go sleeping?
Sleeping.
Oh, sleeping. That's right. I forgot about that.
Well, it's right here in your paper.
It does say it right there.
You wrote it down.
Sleeping.
Yeah. Sleeping.
Sleeping. Sleeping.
Just be careful.
Okay. I do need the promo because he did pay for a promo. I did it again. Don't.
I'm not gonna.
I don't want ash on me again.
Yeah, you've already been punished.
There is a real estate group in the Hampton Roads area. This is not a joke.
I know.
You may think I'm joking.
I know that you're not joking.
I'm not joking. The Maroon Group, real estate. I don't know what the website is. I meant to look that up.
Oh, David, you're
the maroongroup.com. Maybe. Google it. Let me know if I'm right. Home awaits.
Well, I sure feel.
Was that inspiring or what?
I sure feel at home.
Do you feel like buying a house in the Hampton Roads area?
From them, I do because I feel sorry for them that you elicited compassion.
They're doing okay. Pity. Okay, with
no,
even...
I don't pity. I don't.
Okay, that's it, folks. I think that's it.
I think we.
Thanks for being on my cable show.
You know, I'm on your log, and I'm very happy
thanks
to be
here. Thanks for breaking my
log.
Cow lamp.
thanks for breaking my cow lamp.
Thanks for coming over.
Thanks for coming over. Thanks for breaking my cow lamp.
All right. Okay, bye.